Welcome to the Four Corners 912 Project discussion on rules of the game. For a country to exist peaceably as a unified people in the game of life, we all must be playing by the same rule. The rules for our country were established in the Constitution that was agreed upon to abide by. This was and is the supreme law of the land.
To follow the rules, you must know what they are. They are few and clear. We hope to help you all to better understand what the rules are as we are looking to elect new representatives in local and state government offices next year.
They take an oath to uphold the constitutions of both the state and the United States.
What are they to uphold and protect?
We will begin this regular discussion beginning with the Bill of Rights, which is the first 10 amendments of the Constitution.
Welcome back to the Four Corners 912 discussion on rules of the game for our Constitution. Today we're looking at the rest of Amendment 5. As we go into this, we need to keep in mind all these rules or these rights that we're discussing. These are the first 10 amendments. They are God-given. They're not laws given by man. But we make laws around them. In the governance. And this is what we need to look at, is we're electing people for new offices. Do they know what their Constitution says? Are they abiding by it? Or are they making laws that are intended to be enforced that are contrary to the Constitution, causing all kinds of problems? Let's start off with this. Bud, what is the rest of Amendment 5?
Okay, the second half of it starts out, nor shall any person be subject to the same offense to be twice put in jeopardy of life or limb, nor shall be compelled in any criminal case to be a witness against himself, nor be deprived of life, liberty, or property without due process of law, nor shall private property be taken for public use without just compensation.
Well, let's hear about what it means.
Well, let's hear about where it comes from.
Well, all right, let's go for that.
We can't understand what it says without the context. And this goes throughout the whole of the Constitution. But in this particular case where we're dealing with criminal activity here, the reason it's in the Constitution, deriving from the list of particulars in the Declaration of Independence, but it goes way back beyond that, because we remember in seventh grade history, I suppose, that we heard about the Spanish Inquisition and religious torture interrogations where you either recanted your belief or they put you to death. But back in those old days, only the magistrate did the interrogation. The sheriff didn't do that.
Okay.
The sheriff picked you up and brought you in before the magistrate, and he did the interrogation. And that led, in some cases, to what some of us might remember as the Star Chambers. Now, that's a totally negative connotation these days. Started out to not be so.
No.
Star Chamber started out as a special convening for people of some repute, where you might have a national or regional reputation to protect. And so they had what was called the Star Chamber to do that. Well, of course, anything invented by man can be abused, so that's what happened. And now we have this totally negative connotation of the Star Chamber. And, you had no representation, you had no warnings, you had no nothing. You were in there on your own, and whatever they did, they did. And then we get way on down to the way it's being turned around today. Okay? Shall not be a witness against himself, for instance. Just take that one little phrase. So how's that interpreted? One of the ways is the Miranda warning, right?
I remember that.
Well, you remember the Miranda warning. You got a police officer got to read this statement to you about your constitutional rights.
Right.
If you don't know your constitutional rights, you're the problem, not the policeman. And so we've wound up turning the policeman into a constitutional law instructor on the side of the road. No, that just doesn't seem right to me.
Well, but where in the Constitution did the Miranda law...
From right there.
Where did it come from?
Right there.
I don't see it there.
I don't either. But whoever arrested Mr. Miranda did not read the Constitution to him first. You see, didn't read this little thing about being a subject witness against himself.
Well, what I get out of that is that became a, you say, law. That's the way it's treated today. It's treated as a law that was what? Made, created by the court system.
By the courts.
It wasn't done by the legislature.
That
is Congress.
That's...
So it's basically, it almost looks like an unconstitutional law.
I would have to agree with you. And I've said, we've said in a past video, when a policeman pulls you over for whatever, that's not the time to be having an in-depth constitutional discussion.
Well, as I understand it, that started off at a local court in Arizona.
Yep.
And it ended up, finally ended up in Supreme Court of the United States. And so by a decision on one incident, it becomes a law. And this doesn't this come in what they call the doctrine of incorporation? Action in a court carries all the way down, says the state has to, and the local guys,
and the local
to enforce
guys.
What was just a court action.
The Cortez police have to enforce a United States Supreme Court opinion.
Okay. Well, that's part of it. What's this double jeopardy stuff all about?
Well, that's pretty plain and simple. If you go to trial, regardless of the outcome, you can't go to trial a second time. Okay?
Okay.
Now, does that ever happen today? Oh, yeah. Take the simple case of a murder. Some guy shoots some guy, and the local jurisdiction prosecutes. He's found innocent.
Okay.
Well, not found innocent, he's found not guilty.
Okay.
Gotta get that straight. He's found not guilty. So Montezuma County couldn't convict the guy. So the state files charges, murder charges. Well, let's say the state jury finds him not guilty. The federal government jumps in and they decide to file charges, and then they pile on hate crime charges and aggravation charges and all that. The crime was the guy is dead. And the suspect is being tried 3, 4, 5 times for the same offense.
So why does this happen? How can that happen? What's the...
Because the courts, in their opinions, have held that each one of these jurisdictions hold separate sovereignty.
Okay.
And they've said that the double jeopardy only applies to that particular jurisdiction.
Okay.
So only Montezuma County could not try him twice. Only the state could not try him twice. Or only the federal government could not try him twice. But all three jurisdictions could try him.
For the same
crime. Same crime. Same guy is still the same dead.
All right. Tell you what, we have some good sponsors.
Okay.
Let's take a break and appreciate our sponsors.
You betcha. We appreciate them.
It's filled with moments. Moments we share with those we love, worry about, and strive to protect the most. At Woodman Life, we provide insurance and retirement products to help protect you and your family so that you can enjoy all the moments to come.
Okay, let's move ahead.
Move ahead. Thank you very much for that.
Life and limb.
Life or limb. shall be put in jeopardy of life or limb. Now, life and limb there does not refer to life or limb, literally. All that meant was that you might suffer a general penalty, whatever it may be. And so they did not mean literally to take your life in this place, in this amendment. When I was coming up, that phrase was used commonly. I'll thrash you within life or limb if you misbehave or do whatever. Boy, and I'm telling you what, my grandma knew how to do it. But then we get down to the next clause. It says, be deprived of life, liberty, or property. Now, that's literal.
That brings up a question or a thought. In our Declaration of Independence, we talked about life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness.
Yes.
This is life, liberty, or property.
Or property.
What's the history and why has that changed?
No one really knows. But the original Declaration of Independence, written in the hand of Thomas Jefferson, said life, liberty, or property.
Okay.
And nobody is real, none of the historians and all of them guys are not real clear why it was changed to pursuit of happiness.
Well, if you got your own property, you're probably going to be happy.
And it, I don't think it's a significant change because we still have it down here, life, liberty, or property, and and property is referenced in other places also.
It's obviously important to those framers.
They had what was called the Committee on Style. Now, them's the fellows what put in all the commas and semicolons and developed the phraseology. Okay. So whether it was that Committee on Style, you know, this is before it went to the publisher. We'd call it an editor today. But they had a Committee on Style. And that was to make it readable and so forth and so on. The best guess is that they changed it for some unknown reason, but that's not necessarily true. We can't prove it. But and we have the phrase due process, and that phrase also appears in Amendment 14, Clause 1, and it's pretty much just a repeat. And we hear so many arguments in courts today that this defendant was not afforded due process.
Yep.
So, you know, they don't want his conviction overturned because he didn't done it. They want it overturned because he didn't get due process by somebody's definition. So you might think due process is one thing. I might think it's something entirely different. And so that leads to big court cases.
I just want to mention one thing about that property word. When you say they can't be deprived of life, liberty, or property.
Right.
And one of the areas we see that happening today is the taking of private property and our liberty and doing our own lives on our property. And such things as the federal government, via, I'll say EPA, saying you can't build a pond on your own property.
Mm-hmm.
That's a taking of your property.
It sure enough is.
The controlling of your property in any way, or taking it for, non-beneficial use of the public,
mm-hmm.
and controlling through regulations, you can't do on your property what you want to do. Mm-hmm. That's a taking without due process. Anyway, go ahead. I didn't want to interrupt
you. No, that's a very good point, because we now think that these are some of the things, you know, we like to have such an expansive reading of the Constitution. Mm-hmm. It's a living document. Mm-hmm. So we get to life, liberty, or property. Well, maybe not so much, because we didn't change title to the property. We didn't steal it from you, so we obviously didn't take it. No, you deprive me of the use, you're taking it. It's not my property if I don't control it every inch.
Okay.
And that would be right down to the liberty thing that we keep mentioning.
What about an eminent domain? There's a time they can take it.
Yeah, this is the leading into what we call the eminent taking or eminent domain. Nor shall private property be taken for public use without just compensation.
Mm-hmm.
Now,
is there an example of that?
Yeah, the best example just recently was the Kelo versus New Haven, Connecticut, where there was this neighborhood that wasn't in the best of repair, but people lived there, and it wasn't a slum. It just wasn't mansion-like. And so everybody sold out except Mrs. Kelo. This is my house, and I'm going to keep it. So they confiscated her property under eminent domain so that a developer could come in and build a strip mall, I think it was. Anyway, it was going to be a commercial development in this area. And so they took her property, kicked her out of her house so that they could do this. And it went all the way through the courts on the argument that Mrs. Kelo only paid $1 in property taxes.
Small amount.
Very small amount. Compared to the real estate taxes, sales taxes, and income taxes that would be generated by this mall developer. And the argument was that increase in revenue to the city of New Haven was a greater public good than Mrs. Kelo keeping her house.
Sounds like the more good was building the government's coffer.
Yeah, that's the public good.
And did it work?
No. The last time I checked, and this was a couple of years ago, and the case had already been settled, and Mrs. Kelo's gone, and some enterprising reporter went out there and looked, and it had become a dumping ground for the neighborhood. Folks take their old refrigerator and just dump it out there rather than take it to the landfill and pay the fee. They just dump it on this empty lot.
That was for the public good.
That was the public good, as it turns out, was an impromptu dump out there.
Well, there we have Amendment 5 in total.
That's it.
As we move forward, particularly as we're looking at elections coming up, one of the things we need to remember, ask your candidates what they propose to do. They have ideas that for new laws, new regulations, whether it's at a county level regulation, whether it's a state law or regulation, do these laws and regulations stay in context and pursuant to the Constitution of the state of Colorado?
Oh, that's a lovely word.
I like that.
Pursuant.
You taught me that. Or do they violate your personal right, God-given rights, in these first 10 minutes? Keep that in mind as we look forward to our candidates. They're going to promise all kinds of things that they, number one, don't have the authority to do, the power to do, and it's in violation. We've seen that at the last legislature.
Yes.
Let's not have it happen again.
Whether it's personal liberty, whether it's property, your money, or your time, they can't give you any of that without taking it from somebody else. Because the legislature has no asset. In order for that legislator to make you that promise, he's got to take it from somebody else. We have to remember that. That's the only source they have.
And these laws should not be made that are in violation of the Constitution, because then we expect our local police, our local sheriff, to enforce them.
Enforce unconstitutional laws.
Unconstitutional laws. And responsibility of the legislature comes first. Mm-hmm. They should be responsible to not violate the Constitution. And then, of course, that falls down to the enforcement people having to not violate the Constitution, like enforcing an unconstitutional law.
And it puts that street cop in jeopardy of either his conviction or his life.
Yeah. Well, next time we're going to do Amendment 6.
Amendment 6 should be easy one. Yep. 30, 45 seconds. Shortest video yet.
If you believe that, just believe anything.
Stay tuned.
Be back next time.